Good afternoon. My name is Matt Chase. I'm the Executive Director of the National Association of Counties. And on behalf of our state local government coalition, I'm honored to moderate today's panel of some distinguished state and local leaders, as well as a distinguished member of Congress, who I'll introduce in a second. This briefing is sponsored by the National Association of Counties, the National Governors Association, the National Conference of State Legislators, the Council of State Governments, the National League of Cities, the International City County Management Association, the Government Finance Officers Association, and the American Association of State Highway and Transportation Officials, which is just about every state and local government group that cares about transportation. So this time last year, we were talking about trying to get a multi-year surface transportation bill passed, and luckily, we can now celebrate that victory. What we're here to talk about today is the rest of transportation and overall infrastructure, including things like aviation, the water resources bill, but most importantly, we're also going to focus in on tax exempt municipal bonds. And so we're going to hear from Congressman Blumenauer, who's a key member of the House Ways and Means Committee. And I just wanted to frame it real quickly of why we care so much about infrastructure. The United States is currently ranked 11th in the world in the quality of infrastructure. We used to be number one. And if you look at the 10 nations who are above us, they're all key economic competitors. They're Germany, France, England, Hong Kong, Singapore, and some others. So clearly, those nations that are ahead of us in the economic game realize the importance of infrastructure. Second, if you look at the growth of the United States population since 1990, we've increased our population 25%. Some of the representatives today from state and local government will talk about some of that growth in areas such as King County and Puget Sound area. And so when we had 61 million people, obviously the demand on our infrastructure increases. From a county perspective, there's 3,069 counties in this country. If you look at it, 140 counties account for 50% of the population, meaning the other 50% live in over 2,900 counties. And so we care about it from an urban perspective, where we have large numbers of individuals. Our largest county, Los Angeles County, has 10 million people. It'd be the seventh largest state, same size as Ohio or Michigan, down to some of our counties in Texas with 120 people. Regardless of your population size, though, we know that transportation matters. If you look at the vast number of counties that have public lands, for example, one-fifth of the United States land is federal land. We have over 500 million visitors each year, often coming, are always coming on state and local roads to visit. Same thing goes with agriculture, commodity movement, and other natural resources. They rely on a multimodal transportation system. So again, we are really honored to be here today. I want to introduce Congressman Earl Blumenauer from Oregon, who has extensive background here in Washington, but also started his career at the city and county level. So with that, Congressman.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you for the invitation to visit with you. Thanks for actually starting 3 minutes early. This is getaway day on Capitol Hill. You may have seen the stampede of people leaving to various airports around the region. And I will be crawling on a plane myself for my weekly 4,600-mile commute back home. But I did want to spend some time visiting with you for a moment, at least to share some of my perceptions. And I'm quite cranky that I won't be able to continue on with the interaction of the panel. Because when we talk about infrastructure, what is being presented here is really the essence. I strongly believe in the federal role in infrastructure. We'll talk about that in a moment. But as Matt mentioned, I started my career as a legislator, as a county commissioner. I spent 10 years as Portland's commissioner of public works in our odd system of governance. I was one of the five members in the city council, including the mayor, but I also had administrative responsibilities for transportation, for funding, for wastewater. I lived infrastructure up close and personal, including getting sued by EPA and other highlights of my career. That really is where these dramas play out, and they are dramas. You may have noticed that there are a few. How do I say this? There are a few cranky people out there politically this year. There are some strange things afoot. Part of the narrative is that there's a notion that people are angry and frustrated. in both parties. And I think to a certain extent that is the case, in part because a lot of what happens here in Washington, D.C. almost seems beside the point. And in some of our states, I mean, bathroom police, was this a pressing national issue 6 weeks ago? And now you're going to have your birth certificate in some states to be able to use a restroom. I don't know exactly who's going to be enforcing that, but it is symptomatic of how it is much easier for politicians at all levels to deal with things that have emotional or symbolic content, but really don't deal with the everyday lives of the people that elect us. That's why when I came back here, I spent a lot of time dealing with what we call livable communities, the network of policies that help make families safe, healthy, and economically secure. And these are the things that people feel government can actually do something about. Is the drinking water safe? Does the storm water go away and be treated rather than polluting lakes and rivers and creating problems of flooding? Are roads and bridges falling apart? Can children get to school safely on their own? These are things that people have an expectation that government can do something about and should. What the reference that Matt was making in terms of what's occurred in the last 25 years in terms of the explosion of activity in our metropolitan areas that are becoming increasingly focused and defined. And they're the economic center. They're the cultural center. They are the magnets for a number of you millennials here in the room who are the most sought after demographic. People have given up on these or baby boomers like me, although we're second place in some respects. Things that relate to quality of life have really transformed these metropolitan areas. And it's exciting for me as I go around the country. Mr. Ballmer and his colleagues have sent me off to some 200 communities where I've had a chance to be involved in these discussions and seminars and brainstorming activities. We're watching people coming back even to distressed central cities. We're watching common, as disparate as Brooklyn and Houston, revitalization, cycling, the number one. I happen to believe in bike partisanship for a variety of reasons. This was Elise Parker, the former mayor of Houston, when she ran for her third and last campaign, was successful. The number one accomplishment, as far as Houstonians were concerned, was a $200 million bond for cycling. We're seeing streetcars in over two dozen communities around the country. People care about this. My message is pretty simple. First and foremost, don't give up on the federal government for being a partner in the resources. This has been something that has been part of the history of infrastructure in this country, back with Benjamin Franklin's postal roads or Abraham Lincoln's Transcontinental Railroad, Eisenhower's interstate freeway system. These were nonpartisan. These were areas of the federal government driving technology and investment that led to tremendous prosperity, tying the country together. And the federal government has a role to play going forward. The Highway Trust Fund is going bankrupt. We gave you a five-year reauthorization with a tiny, insignificant, but welcome increase in funding and 5 years of stability. But at the expense of gimmicks that are going to give us a larger cliff here in 4.5 years and make it harder for the federal government to play its role in dealing with this partnership with state, local, and the private sector. We have to change the funding mechanisms. A fuel tax, which Oregon gave you in 1919, the first dedicated highway tax, a gas tax for infrastructure, is no longer remotely adequate. There is no good relationship anymore between volume of fuel consumed and road user benefit. And fixed fees per gallon are going to continue to collect less and less with more fuel-efficient vehicles, electric, plug-in hybrids, let alone what's going to happen with electric autonomous vehicles. We have to have a different model. Oregon, again, is riding to the rescue. We're in our 10th year of a pilot project dealing with paying for road use with a user charge, keeping track of how far people go. How far, not where, how far people travel, and having a fee that is collected in exchange for that. And it's going to do more than just pay for road use. This technology is going to enable us to have a seamless experience for people who travel in the United States. The same technology that will pay for your road use and bill you automatically will enable to pay for tolls, for parking, let you know where the closest parking space is, bike share, car share, Uber, Amtrak, all on one integrated system that will drive down the unit costs and dramatically improve the quality of the transportation experience. This is not science fiction. It's coming very, very quickly. Part of it is the change in the whole motoring experience. I spent a day last week in Silicon Valley looking at the autonomous vehicle technology, what's happening with drones. And this is on its way, and it's going to be radically disruptive this decade. The major source of employment for men with less than a college education is driver. In 29 states, it's the number one job category. What's the future for that over the course of the next 20 years? And with autonomous vehicles that are going to have a radically different safety profile, 95% of the accidents, as you know, are human error. It's going to happen with auto body shops. Auto insurance, what is that profile going to look like? 6.5 million people who are involved with the production and sales of vehicles. And we've got great quantities of the landscape tied up in transportation patterns from the last century. How many parking garages 15 years from now will not support the bond payments that'll be, what are they going to be used for? Homeless shelters? What's going to happen with road right-of-way? You look at what's occurring in communities around the country now recapturing pavement for bike and pedestrian activities, for plazas. There's a whole new world out there for adaptive reuse in our communities. And it's coming at us over the course of the next 20 years. At the same time, we've got to be investing in what we've got now. And I appreciate the reference to water, because what's under the surface is in worse shape than our roads and bridges. We have 1.8 million miles of sewer and water lines, many of which have reached their useful life. And in part, local governments have done such a great job because we turn on the tap and it's usually safe to drink, and we hose down the driveway or flush the toilet and the water goes away, and it's relatively inexpensive. That's going to change. So this conversation about the partnerships that are necessary, I think, is extraordinarily timely, and it is something that we all have to be involved with. Infrastructure investment is the quickest way to put a couple million people to work at family wage jobs in every city around the country. It's the way to revitalize the economy, to improve the environment, and I would say bring people together. I appreciate your having this conversation. I look forward to being your partner in Congress if my voters send me back next Congress. I think with a new administration and a Congress that I think is poised to be better partners, we've got an opportunity to get ahead of these technological changes and these steep financial challenges we have to be able to make our communities more livable and our families safer, healthier, and more economically secure. Thank you very much.
As you can see, the congressman has a ton of vision and passion, and I'll just mention before he leaves, I was recently down in Memphis talking to a regional economic development summit, and the number two guy at FedEx was talking about autonomous vehicles, and 30% of the employment base in the Memphis area is related to transportation logistics, and what platooning will do with 18-wheelers and shipping, what that will do to the economic workforce. So you're right on when you talk about the impact. So thank you again. At this point, we're going to turn over to our panel of state and local experts. I'll introduce them all now, and then they'll each give 5 minutes, but we'll have time for Q&A. Our first speaker will be the Honorable Judy Clyburn from Washington State. She's a representative there, where she served for 13 years in the legislature. She's currently in her 8th year as chair of the House Transportation Committee. She's no stranger to public service in addition to her tenure at the state level. She also was a mayor and councilwoman for Mercer Island in the state of Washington. Then we'll have the Honorable Han Bremer, who's a council member from Montgomery County, Maryland. He's here on behalf of the National Association of Counties. She also mentioned that representatives here is for the Council of State Governments. Hans Reimer was first elected to the County Council in 2010. He'll be talking about some of the transportation issues in the Washington area, including the Purple Line, which is associated with the Metro. Then we'll hear from Mayor Craig Thurman, who's the mayor of Broken Arrow, Oklahoma. He's on behalf of the National League of Cities. Mayor Thurman's no stranger as well to public service. He's been in the United States Marine Corps, he's a Vietnam vet. Prior to serving as mayor, he served on the city council and was vice mayor twice of the city of Broken Arrow, which I think he says is about 108,000 people in the Tulsa County. And then our last speaker will be Dr. Cheryl Bailey, the deputy county administrator for Chesterfield County, Virginia, which is down near the Richmond area. She'll be speaking on behalf of the International City County Management Association. She also has extensive background at the state level, where she was the executive director of the State Municipal Bond Bank. So she has a perspective from the state level as well as the local level. So at this point, I'll turn it over to Representative Clever.
Thank you, Matt. Well, I was asked to come here and share with you something that's very exciting in our state, because we, after 3 years of work, passed an 11.9-cent gas tax. It was a bipartisan move. It took 3 years because it was a lot, there was a lot in it. And we're very proud of the fact that we actually got this passed before we knew there was going to be any federal dollars. This is a wonderful partnership now that we can make our money at the local level go even farther. So part of that money was shared with the locals. We appointed the 11.9 of it went to cities and counties. We have this history with our gas tax in the past. That's what we have done. And this is for 16 years, so it's all the gas tax that is collected will be spent, and much of it will be bonded, and we'll be building projects for 16 years. A lot of it had to do with jobs and economic development. That was very important. Both sides had a lot at stake. And we did local options. We had a number of cities that, or counties that needed transit local option gas taxes. We authorized that. And another part of it was we have a lot of projects that are at the local level that we partnered up with. So we didn't fund them completely, but we have partnerships that we do with our state dollars as part of the package. And it wasn't just about roads, because we had $1 billion for multimodal. And multimodal means the bicycle, pedestrian, and transits. And this was mostly on grant programs, but that was more than we've ever had in our previous funding at the state level. So this was a big move. It took a lot of negotiations to get that. And part of the negotiations on moving into a more balanced approach to transportation funding and what we pay for at the state level had to do with making sure that we did efficiencies and reform. And that was the bipartisan makeup of how we got to spend large amounts of money on things that some people didn't want to spend money on. Well, we also have $1 billion that we put into preservation. And there will be ongoing money besides this, but this is on top of our regular preservation budget. The reforms that we had were very interesting, and I'm just going to talk about a couple, because these were the keys that opened the door for people who wouldn't normally vote for a gas tax, if they could say that they did efficiencies and that they had made changes and streamlining either the permitting or the environmental regulations, those kinds of things. They also there were efficiencies on how we delivered the projects. And we were at a program just today, we were talking with people who were saying that we shouldn't be delivering our projects the same way we've always done it. That the engineering, these projects had been on the books, some of them 20 years. They had been engineered and looked at, and they were still on there to solve the same problem, but nobody had looked at them in over those many years to see if there was a better way, more efficient way to solve the problem. So we actually embedded in this program an efficient way to look at every project and book the savings from what we had put in there to say, this is how the old project would have cost. When we get through looking at the projects and make the savings, we're going to put that in the bank and make it available in the future. So those are the kinds of things that we were trying to do. We gave the Regional Transit Authority authorization to go out for $15 billion in local option taxes, so that was a part of the agreement. And it has been, it's actually rolling out to the voters this year, although it's been doubled. So it's now, they're looking at $30 billion for the transportation, Sound Transit. I, in particular, want you to know that the partnerships that we have made with all of our partners, like locals, but also with the labor unions, the chambers, they all came in to help us do this. The cities and counties have been big partners with us, and I would say that when we start looking for our partnerships with the federal government, we have asked them to be very generous with their TIFIA and TIGERS, because those kinds of things really do make a difference for those of us on the ground. And so I think when we look into the future, we are right behind Oregon at looking at road user charges. We are doing it in a slightly different way because we don't want to just reinvent the same wheel, but we are asking for the federal government in their new authorization for some of their money to work on our road user pilot project. So we will be looking, because we know that this may be the last gas tax we get passed. It's not going to be as efficient in the future. So we're looking into the future and making sure that we take good care of always having some way to pay for our infrastructure.
Great, thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate the invitation to be here today. Hans Remering, one of the at-large members for the Montgomery County Council. So I think most of you in the room probably know very much where Montgomery County is, right here in the Washington region. I'm representing the large Urban County Caucus with NACO. The Urban County Caucus brings together counties like Montgomery County, Prince George's County, where often you'll see a county is much more analogous to a big city government than, you know, other county governments. The county structure varies a lot from, as Matt mentioned, from a rural county with a small population to what is functionally a big city government. Montgomery County has 1 million people. We are the local government primarily for most people who live in Montgomery County, Maryland, because Maryland runs on a county-based system for the most part. So I see the mayor of College Park is here in the back, Mr. Patrick Wohan. So there is a strong municipal layer to governance in Maryland. In Montgomery County, as in the rest of the state, the county is a major player. We are the infrastructure engines at the local level, part of a three-part partnership, federal, state, and local. And today we passed our capital budget, so I'm very fresh in my mind, you know, what we are paying for. Our capital budget's about $350 million a year in local funding, with additional funding from federal and state partners. But we're paying for roads, you know, bridge reconstruction, schools. We have nearly $200 million going into school construction. Parks, libraries, community centers, bike lanes. Separately, we have WSSC, which has its own capital program, spending really billions over years to rebuild all the pipe network. And all of these projects really add up and are dependent upon, largely dependent on our local bonding authority. So I'll talk in a moment just about municipal bonds, and you're going to hear more about that on the panel, but we have to raise taxes and then bond that money in order to pay for most of this. So the thing that I want to, you know, convey is that at the local level, we need a strong federal partner in order to think big about infrastructure. The torturous path of getting a major infrastructure project accomplished is significant. And, you know, you face opposition to do infrastructure at every turn. The Purple Line is a great story of getting a major project accomplished. It was really dreamed up by local activists who wanted solutions that were alternatives to widening the Beltway, or ever widening cycle of widening the Beltway. And they came up with the idea of building a transit line on the inner Beltway. That project was conceived maybe 30 years ago. And just now, in the current year, we're hoping to break ground in construction. That's how long it takes to get a major project like that done. And a project like that has to survive opposition from neighbors along the way who are frustrated by it. We had a powerful country club that for many years dominated Montgomery County politics and managed to prevent the Purple Line from moving forward. We had to survive ambivalence from elected leadership at the state and local level who were responding to that opposition, whether from the country club or from others. We had to survive a competitive environment with other infrastructure projects. You know, we had major highways that were jockeying to get the next investment from the state and federal government. We have other transit projects jockeying to get the investment from the federal and state government. And the crucial moment for the Purple Line really came about last year and 2 years ago. And I can't tell you how many times I had a conversation with a representative from a rival project. We still have a lot of enthusiasm about bus rapid transit, but there was a strong push in Montgomery County to abandon the federally funded Purple Line and substitute for it a locally funded bus rapid transit system. And the rationale that was proposed was that the federal government's not going to be there. So why should we bother? Why don't we just pull back on our request to the state government, and they will pull back on their request to the federal government, because the money's just not going to be there. And let's just focus on what we can do here locally with our dollars. Well, the reality is we can't do that as much locally with our dollars. And that was a real dead end. But many of us persevered and said, we believe the federal government is going to be there, despite what you've heard about the dysfunction at Congress or the uncertainties with the trust fund. We believe that the funding will be there. And it was a little bit of a faith-based, you know, position, but we came down, we met with FTA, and we heard from them. They pay for, federal government pays for almost $1 billion of this project. But without a $1 billion funding source on the other end of this project, we would never be able to get the state to put up the $500 million they're going to put up, and we're putting up probably about $250 million. So what you'd have is you wouldn't have the ability to dream big about really big infrastructure. You'd get a lot of, you know, widening of an intersection here and there at the local level, but you wouldn't get projects that can move 50,000, 75,000 people a day and transform a major part of the Washington region. And that's what the Purple Line is going to do. So as I said, we had to push back aggressively against the argument that the federal government won't be there. So we need federal government to be there, and local governments all across the country need the federal government to be there. They need a strong partner. And the last thing I want to say is, you know, as the local infrastructure engine, if you make financing more expensive, then you will get less infrastructure. It's very simple. So just because there is a tax subsidy for local infrastructure doesn't make it bad. You know, the question is, what is the tax subsidy accomplishing? And accomplishing the creation of infrastructure is a good thing. So I know there's a lot of pressure to get rid of tax expenditures and so forth, but this is a tax expenditure that produces positive outcomes and is a really good investment by the federal government. If the tax benefits change for municipal financing, then we'll have to pay for, you know, our daughter won't go as far. And so we won't be able to build as many schools, roads, parks, libraries, and we won't be able to contribute as much towards major projects like the Purple Line. So, you know, we need you to, you know, re-secure the role of the federal government so that local governments all across the country can continue to think big and make this country, you know, get the major projects going, and please hold the line on our municipal lots. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I agree with Hans. When you look at, it's so important that federal government is a participant and for local government. For us to be able to do things, it's very important. I want to talk a little bit about job growth and economic development and how it's spurred by infrastructure. And this is on a small local level. And talk about infrastructure. A lot of people in the room have no idea, never heard of Broken Arrow, Oklahoma before, and so it is in the very center of the country. And we're approximately 108,000 people with the third largest city in the state of Oklahoma, or the fourth largest city in the state, and the third largest manufacturing base, mainly advanced manufacturing. Wanted to talk a little bit about the growth that we've had and how that's been spurred. And we have approximately 10,000 jobs that are in advanced manufacturing. 85% of those, when they come to us and they say, we're looking for a place to expand or to grow, they need infrastructure. That's the first thing they need, is shovel-ready infrastructure. And so that's important. We have to provide that. And some of our manufacturers, our largest manufacturer is Flight Safety International, which is a Berkshire Hathaway company. They are the largest manufacturer of flight simulators in the world. They're all manufactured in Broken Arrow. They were wanting to leave and go to Texas, and Texas offered them a very attractive package. We provided $6.5 million worth of infrastructure and some land for them that was sitting on land on a lease, and they were able to retain them. They grew at that time from 585 jobs to almost 800 jobs, with another 760 jobs that are for their suppliers that built parts for them. So retaining that in our community was very important. Another one of our large manufacturers is Zeeco. They manufacture flares and different parts for the energy business and for refineries. And they have really, despite the downturn of oil, they have still been growing. Again, they need infrastructure, and they're wanting to grow and expand. They think they're going to double in size. They are almost 800 employees. Over the next 5 years, they plan to double in size. But for that, they want us to provide signalization, traffic control, some other things for them to be able to grow their business. That, again, infrastructure, and it's done on a local level. Tactical Electronics is another very interesting company that we have, advanced manufacturer. They work with the CIA, Special Forces, and they provide bomb disassembling equipment and surveillance equipment. During the Aurora, Colorado incident that happened there, that tragedy, you may remember some pole cameras looking into some of the perpetrator's apartment. Those were all manufactured and broken air by Tactical Electronics. They're such a cutting edge company that they do not copyright or patent anything that they do. They by the time someone's copied their product, they've moved on to the next product. Again, they're looking at growing and expanding, and they want us to provide infrastructure. And then our Rose District is a arts and entertainment district that we have invested, started out with $5 million, now we've invested slightly less than $10 million as public funds, and in 4 years we have over $30 million of private investment. IEDC, the International Economic Development Council, gave us an award for the top public-private partnership in North America. So it's really very successful, but it's all done with infrastructure. We've narrowed our streets, we've put rose planters in. Broken Arrow was known at the turn of the century as the city of springs, natural springs and roses, so we've gone back to that. In the 1900s, we've gone back to that and called this the Rose District. And this is short as 3 to 4 years ago. You would go to our Rose District at night and our downtown, and we would say if there was a car there, it's because it wouldn't start. I mean, there was nothing going on, there was nothing happening, and over the last 3 years, it's grown where you can't find a parking space anywhere in downtown. It's always exciting not to be able to park. But and so that's really, it's been quite an investment that we've done there, and that was all done through infrastructure. So it's so important on the local level. We do all this with municipal government bonds, GO bonds that we, general obligation bonds that we issue that our taxpayers vote for. And that is so important that they're tax exempt, because we could do very little if we, or a lot less if we didn't have tax exempt bonds. So that's important to us, but we do need the federal participation to be able to accomplish the things that we've accomplished in the past few years. And we continue to see our job growth. Our most exciting thing that we're working on right now is an innovation district. And we've partnered with Northeastern State University. We have 93 acres that we're going to do the only research and development innovation district in the state of Oklahoma. And that for that, we're going to have to bring, we're supplying broadband from multiple different suppliers so that we have different broadband available. We are putting roads in, we're putting sewer and water in, and bringing the infrastructure to that area. And we've got several private manufacturers that are wanting to do research and development there. And we think it'll be a huge growth for us. But again, we're using some EDA grants and some other forms of federal funding to help incentivize. But our taxpayers, using TIFs and other forms of local funding, are going to take the majority of that. So it's important that we get that small contribution from the federal government to be able to do a lot of really good things in our community. National League of Cities has a brochure, if you have not picked it up, outside, that they just published this week, called Paying for Local Infrastructure in a New Era of Federal Liberalism. So I'd like for everyone to pick that up if anyone would like. I've got flash drives about a couple little short videos of Broken Arrow, and a blog that I did about infrastructure and economic development, and some of the information that I presented today. Well, thank you.
Thank you, Mayor.
Going the wrong way.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm Cheryl Bailey, Deputy County Administrator for Chesterfield County, and I'm representing the International City County Management Association and its Governmental Affairs and Policy Committee this afternoon. Chesterfield is one of the larger full-service communities in Virginia. We are in the Richmond area. We have proximity to the cities of Richmond and Petersburg. We do not have any incorporated cities and towns in our jurisdiction. We have about over 330,000 in population and a geographic area of 446 square miles. As an urbanizing county, we have a dynamic blend. We have revitalization initiatives, as well as significant remaining rural areas. So anything related to local government, we have it from A to Z. I'm supposed to remember to do this. That's me. In terms of impact in local government, building and maintaining infrastructure is one of the core functions, as you heard this afternoon, of state and local governments, and their investments are essential. A recent white paper that the ICMA's our committee sponsored, and it's out there front, so we do want you to see this too, on municipal bonds and infrastructure. That study found that state and local governments invested nearly $400 billion, and that's billion to be in capital projects in 2014. And that is a significant slowdown. So that the 2014 investment is a significant slowdown. The economic downturn, with that, low state and local governments had to cut capital spending, and we have not yet returned to the pre-Great Recession levels. Infrastructure is the linchpin, as you've heard, of our U.S. economy, improving the quality of life, creating jobs, and sustaining economic development. And that is something that I feel very strongly as a trained or reforming economist, if you will. Generally, state and local government, and the amount that we invest at the state and local level, is significant. The state and local governments expend 70% of total capital spending, net of federal grants, based on Bureau of Economic Analysis data. Our productive capacity as a country and as an economy is dependent on this infrastructure, and the state and local government infrastructure investments are pivotal. These state and local government investments help our communities run well. Educational facilities are the largest overall investment that state and local governments make, providing the public schools, colleges, and universities that educate our future workforce. Other vital state and local investments include our public sidewalks, roads, highways, bridges, and mass transit systems that our workers use to travel to work, as well as the public water and sewer facilities that you've heard this afternoon, and other infrastructure that power our economy. A recent example is Chesterfield County. While a conservative community, our Chesterfield residents overwhelmingly, 78%, approved a $304 million bond issue in 2013 for school facility improvements. These school projects in this latest referendum mainly focus on the revitalization or replacement of 10 older schools, with the average age of 62 years of the targeted elementary schools and 47 years for the middle schools. As you can imagine, the community really wants us to upgrade those schools, and we are working diligently to get that work done in 7 years. Tax-exempt municipal bonds are a key tool for us to be able to afford to renovate and replace those older schools within the 7 years, within our existing resources, and maintain our AAA bond ratings. If the financing costs went up, then the implementation timetable would extend to well past 10 years. And the schools are already 50 to 60 years old on average. That's something our community would have real serious concerns about. As state and local governments maintain the daily operations of our schools, as well as the public safety and full gamut of community services, debt financing is a key tool, it's a primary tool actually, that allows them to also, allows us to also invest in educational, transportation, and water and other infrastructure. Our study, our recent ICMA white paper found that approximately 90% of state and local capital spending is financed with debt, mainly through the use or the issuance of municipal bonds. Now, while there are other alternative financing mechanisms, such as pay-as-you-go and P3s, which are also useful and important tools, they are effective for only a certain types of projects, and they are not a robust alternative for the vast majority of the traditional capital projects. The tax exemption on municipal bonds is critical to state and local government continuing their majority investments in the nation's infrastructure. If the tax exemption were repealed, state and local government would have paid $714 billion in additional interest expense in 2014, as found in the recent ICMA white paper. This translates into 2 to 6 million extra interest expense on the average municipal bond transaction of $29 million. These additional costs would be passed on to taxpayers. Thus, limiting or eliminating the exemption likely would mean less infrastructure investment, negatively impacting the quality of life we've all talked about, the economic and the economic vitality of all our communities, rural, suburban, and urban. Municipal bonds are a proven and cost-effective tool to build and maintain this essential infrastructure. And preserving this tool for state and local governments is good investment for America. I appreciate the opportunity to speak on this very pertinent topic this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you, Dr. Valley. I'm just sitting here thinking, someone who's been in D.C. for almost 25 years and used to hearing billions and trillions of dollars, to hear state and local officials using hundreds of millions and billions of dollars just for their local jurisdictions kind of blows me away. To hear three counties in the Seattle area talking about a $30 billion investment over 15 years. So I can imagine as a state and local official, it's very unnerving when you hear either the White House or the Congress talking about dramatic reforms to tax-exempt municipal bonds. And our experience here has been people's eyes glaze over when you use the term tax-exempt municipal bonds. But then you have to explain to them that if we're talking K-12 schools, hospitals, airports, water, sewer, roads, and bridges. And then, of course, we always get accused of funding stadiums. which we'll put those aside for today. But can you talk a little bit about what it's like at the state and local level to be trying to package these deals at these astronomic numbers, and as elected officials and as a county administrator, how you come to make a decision knowing that the federal government may or may not get there? And Hans, you talked about it a little bit, but Representative, when you're talking about raising your gas tax, how much of it was driven by local need, state need, and then the federal funding not keeping up with inflation and cost of projects?
So for a couple of years before we got this passed, I was beginning to use the term irrelevant. And I think because we could not count on whether there would ever be anything from the federal government, it didn't really look like it was ever going to happen. So most of our thinking was we were doing it alone. And I think that's one reason that we got the support that we had for such a large amount. It was a pretty big lift, but it was because we had both sides of our aisle working together. We were shocked to have the federal government actually come forward and be able to be a partner, and that is just gravy for us, because we had gone out and looked at all the needs, and we put together a package that had everything that we thought we would need for the next at least decade that we could identify. It didn't give us any room for inflation. It didn't give us any room for new things that were going to come along. We knew we didn't have enough for maintenance preservation, so we were going to have to take the savings and make sure that if somebody didn't have a project for 16 years, they were toast. And we kept saying to them, you know, don't be afraid if you didn't get in this package. Because if you have an emerging issue that comes forward that needs funding, we're going to have savings in the current projects. And in 8 years, that money will become available for you to get started. Because we never saw that the feds were going to ever be able to come and help us.
Thank you. As I said, in the 11th hour of getting the Purple Line funding through the state, which was our first hurdle, we had to raise the gas tax at the state level in order to fill our transportation trust fund sufficiently to provide the state's portion. So in order to do that, we had to persuade people that there was projects that we could fund, and we built a coalition to support the gas tax rise at the state level based on the infrastructure projects that each county would get. And so we were really dependent on the hope that the federal government would be there to pay for the Purple Line, because the Purple Line is what got Montgomery and Prince George's County really together on supporting the gas tax increase. And that's where most of the votes really come from, the state legislature. Then, once you got the state money, things turned a little bit as Governor Larry Hogan was elected in that election, and, you know, dynamics changed a little bit, and we were on edge as to whether he was going to, you know, agree to proceed with the Purple Line. And then finally, you know, the question at the county level was, is this going to be our priority? Is this our ask? And that's really where I experienced it most acutely. You know, there were political interests for other infrastructure projects that repeatedly made the argument that the federal government wasn't going to be there, and we should just proceed on our own. Now, you know, I applaud those jurisdictions that decide to proceed on their own. Seattle has done that, right?
State of Washington.
But there's a cost to that, and there's only so much blood in the stone. So if you want to raise taxes for that purpose, you can't necessarily raise them for another purpose. And what are the appropriate roles? If local governments have to take on the mega infrastructure projects, that's less money that they have for teachers and parks and libraries and those things that only local governments can really provide. So, you know, a state can put together a large project. Local governments, they can't do it by themselves. You know, it's just not possible. So if you don't have a strong federal funding partner, you're just not going to get projects coming up from the local to the state level in the long term.
Can you explain a little bit, because we hear the term a lot, innovative financing, and it makes it sound like you don't need a revenue source to pay back the financing, which of course you do. Can you talk about how your county actually raises your revenue through property tax, sales tax, what your revenue source is, and why it's limited?
Well, you'll read about it in the news today if you live here. We just raised what's called the recordation tax for our capital budget. So whenever you buy a home, you basically, you know, it's essentially a tax on the recordation of your property. And we raised it, you know, by a substantial amount. The average home, I think, will be paying somewhere in the neighborhood of $400 more at the time of sale. Very high-priced homes will be paying a couple $1,000s at the time of sale. That's not easy to do. There's a lot of opposition to doing that. And we had to do it because we just ran out of, there aren't enough bonds to go around. And we have maxed out our bonding authority, and we're still not even close to meeting our local needs. So we had to raise taxes to provide current revenue, you know, in order to get closer to meeting our needs for school construction.
So Mayor, you talked a lot about economic development, and can you explain to us what it's like to sit down with the CEO of a business and have a conversation about, you either provide the local infrastructure, or we're going to locate in Texas, in this case, or it could be China or any other nation. Can you talk about what that's like and how quickly you also need to move?
Well, yeah, those decisions are made a lot faster than in government on the private sector. So we did have to respond very quickly to what they wanted. They were offered $20 million to, particularly in a flight safety situation, to move to Texas. We didn't have $20 million available, and so they wanted to stay, luckily, in our community, and we were able to do a TIF. Our schools got on board, and in Oklahoma, we're the last state in the United States that cities run off sales tax. We don't have ad valorem by right or any other type of funding, income tax or other funding. So we run off sales tax only, so all we can offer is sales tax on our side of the TIF. The schools get the ad valorem and the county gets the ad valorem. So we can do geo bonds, which we can pass with the voters, and we do one about every 3 years. And that is ad valorem. But so we had to figure out a way we could do it, a creative way, and luckily it was important enough to our school district and to us that we were able to do a TIF. And we had happened to have some land that we weren't, a hill that we could level and spend quite a bit of money level if they could put their manufacturing facility on that was owned by the city that had water tanks on top of it. So it was something that really we had to figure this out in a period of about 90 days, whether we were going to try to come up with some kind of deal, and then they had to run it through their corporate organization to see if they would accept what we could provide, and we determined that we could have the capacity to provide about $6.5 million of infrastructure of what was going to be needed in new roads, in work on the hill, and give them a 99-year lease at $1 a year for a place for them to be. So. It had to happen very rapidly, and it was something that really had to happen, and we had to make that decision. But we knew the jobs were so important, and we have three major simulation companies in Broken Arrow. We like that type of manufacturing and want to continue that synergy that we have going on with all those entities being there. So losing the largest one was going to be really devastating to our workforce and to our economy. And you know, it was about trying to retain the jobs and employment for our citizens.
Representative Cullen?
Well, I was just going to make an observation that all of us have been successful at doing something because there was a common thread of need. And I think we had a group of people who were very motivated to pass one brand new project that was in the package, but it was connected to the ports. And so it was called the Gateway Project, and it was a gigantic project, actually outside of King County and the next county, but it had so many proponents. And it brought in the chambers, brought in labor, and as we put a coalition together, I'm listening to everybody, and it's always this need, this vision that you have, and then you try and bring all the people together, and not everybody can get on board for the same reason. But if you keep bringing people in for different reasons. I just thought that was interesting that all of us were actually doing the same thing for different reasons, but we were doing it in the same way by bringing together that need needed to be done.
Well, that's why the old saying used to be, if I support my project, it's an earmark. If it's somebody else's project, it's pork.
Yeah.
So, Dr. Bailey?
Yes, certainly that need, being very need-based, and in the state and local government, we have a very, and particularly local government, we have a very, very close relationship with our citizenry and with our constituents. And a couple of comments. One, with regard to how do you get a package together, and it is very need-based. We are a full-service community, which means there are no overlapping, cities or towns. So from our tax base, it is primarily real estate, personal property, sales, business license. And so that's how we fund everything. But also, we fund the schools. We get the local portion of the schools. We have the local portion for all social services, mental health, utilities. Everything is there. So we are the full service. We are the one local government. And Chesterfield is the lowest cost general government. We are the lowest cost per capita in the state of Virginia, according to the Auditor of Public Accounts report. So we are focused on meeting that need and meeting it effectively. That being the case, we have found that our residents have voted for every bond referendum since 1980. And it's because it is very need-based. It is on the schools. They know what the schools are. We go through a process with the community to find which schools need to be fixed, or next ones need to be built, or where they need to be built. It is on those things. It's the emergency communication systems. It's the 911 when they call police and fire. They know what they're using. It's the libraries. It's the recreational facilities. So they have supported all of those. But also, we have found that our business community has come to the table and supported some key strategic projects. One of them was the creation and extension of a interchange off of Interstate 295 into a industrial park that we had. We have several hundred acres and wanted to develop. It was a partnership with federal funds, state funds, this is to build this interchange. Also, local funds and the business community came with a dedication of some of our business-based taxes and fees. And we came together, we built that interchange. It was the right thing to do. Within a year of the opening, we had a 1 million square foot facility with Amazon there. So,
we have a couple of minutes left. We can open it up to the audience if there's any questions or comments.
Wondering, primarily for Mayor Thurman, when you're faced with a company moving, how do you vet their long-term goals and how do you develop trust that your investment is going to be protected long-term?
I think in our situation, the one that we recently did with Flight Safety, they've been in our community over 10 years, being one of Warren Buffett's companies. We figured they were financially viable, but the product that they develop and that they build there is they're the largest flight simulator manufacturer in the world, and there is quite a bit of demand. And as we see federal budgets going down for what they do on the government side and also on the private side, we knew that there was a lot more demand for simulation. It was cheaper to put someone in a simulator than it was to put them in an airplane and train them. So this particular company, we'd have to look at other ones, but this is one that's wanted to stay, and we're incentivized. We have other companies that want to grow, and we know that they've been in our community a long time, and they want infrastructure, and so we're figuring out ways to do that, and we're doing that with TIF funding and with geo bonds, which we pass. And on that note, there has been a challenge with the tax exempt status of those limits what we can do, helps what we can do. If that goes away, it'll limit what we can do. So that's very important to us. But when we pass bonds, because of the inflation, we only name 80% of our projects. We've learned that's the way to do it. And we very seldom, in the 15 years I've been on council, have been able to ever do 100% of what we had planned to do with those bonds because of inflation. And so we have one currently that we're looking at, a Tiger grant, that will help us to complete our bond packages that we had for the last, our 2014 package. So, but to answer your question, it's really, I think it's a case-by-case basis, and someone that has a viable business plan and has been successful for years it was easy for us to, and the average salary was a very high salary, so it was important for us to maintain those jobs. And their biggest challenge has been finding more people, their employment challenge, which is a good problem to have in our community. We have several manufacturers doing that.
Any other questions? Hal.
Hal Hingster with Summit Strategies. Honorable Representative Clever, I'm wondering, you talked about how you convinced the legislators to be supportive of a fairly substantial gas tax package by convincing them that there would be cost savings from projects that were already on the books that you were reconsidering, redesigning. Where did those savings come from?
And it is difficult to describe, but if you have a long list of projects like we have that have been around for maybe 10 or 15 years, they have a price tag on what it would cost. And if you go out and you just build them that way, it may cost that much. We had a new leadership within the DOT who was saying, we need to look at how you put this out. Do you need to have the same width of shoulders? Do you need to have an overpass, or would a roundabout do? So going down to every community where these projects, we had to go through a process, a practical design process, and it was a new way of looking at engineering. And we've been hearing about it here from other people, so I don't think it's a brand new idea, but it isn't implemented, and I had never heard about it. So in looking at that at those projects, we had billions of dollars lined up to spend on the projects. As they were rolling out in the new way, they were actually averaging 40% savings. So we took a 20% savings of those billions of dollars and said, you can't just move that over to another project. It goes into this account to be available in 8 years. That's the toast account.
Thank you. Morgan will be looking at it soon.
So this is actually something that came up at a panel earlier today. I was wondering if any of you could talk a little bit about how your different jurisdictions prioritize infrastructure projects, and then also things that you do to look at the costs and benefits. And if those aren't things that your jurisdictions are doing, like, well, what are some of the roadblocks, I guess, to doing more of that work?
Well, I guess the process of prioritizing infrastructure is a very political one that has its origins really in the visions of different candidates who run for office and get elected. And so in our capital budget, we are trying to put a lot more emphasis on school construction, because Montgomery County public schools have been growing the size of a high school every year for like the last 7 years. And believe me, we haven't had 7 high schools. So we're trying to respond to the incredible demand of our residents for capacity projects. And in order to do that, we have had to delay other projects. We have to raise taxes. We didn't like doing that, but there was really no way to even get close, so without raising the recreation tax. So we've done that. We've delayed certain road infrastructure projects. In the Washington region, really the economic development, the investment is moving very close to Metro, and we are trying to align our investment strategy to infrastructure that supports that lifestyle. And so we have delayed a number of road projects in order to make room for other projects. And it's challenging. It's definitely challenging, but I think it really finds its root in what's the politics of the community. And in our community, there's a lot of concern about education, the environment, sustainability, and walkability, bikeability, those kind of things.
So I could just jump in on that. I will say that as a transportation budget, we are separate from the general fund. We have a big deal that we need to fund education. And it was very political. The interesting piece was that we had a coalition that included the environmental community. So it was labor, chamber, and the environmental community. And they were the ones who helped balance the conversation so that it wasn't all roads, that we got the authorization for the RTA, and that we had bicycle, pedestrian, complete streets. So even though we have a lot of projects, and that was done by, who's going to vote? Just frankly, you count the votes, you have to have a project to get a vote.
Well, in our community, we don't have some challenges everyone else has because we're elected nonpartisan, so we don't have that, and we're elected at large, so we don't have wards and districts. So it really makes it a lot easier to govern because we don't have any of those issues to deal with. What we do is we do studies of our roads, traffic counts, where our growth patterns are as far as for infrastructure of our roads, and as far as sewer and water, we've had some failing sewer and water systems that we know we have to take care of, and so we address those and where our growth is. So it's a very simple, for our community, it's a lot easier than it is in a lot of the country because of our system.
So Mayor, just quickly to add on to that for Dr. Bailey-Jones, and because we are talking about federal, state, local partnership, oftentimes federal agencies come in and demand cities and counties upgrade the infrastructure. In our case, we own over 3,000 jails. And it's not unusual for the Department of Justice to come in, put a county under consent decree, and mandate they build a new jail. Los Angeles County has the largest jail system in the country, over 16,000 inmates a day. They're trying to replace their central jail. And Greg here's from LA County can tell you it's $2 to $3 billion to build a new jail, because they have to build essentially a new hospital within it because of the mentally ill and those with substance abuse and other issues. So that's a very expensive proposition. It's almost the size of HUD's community development block grant program just for one facility. So then you have EPA coming in on the water and wastewater side routinely asking, and combined sewer overflow can be over $1 billion just for one city, whether it's St. Louis, Kansas City, the list goes on, or typically in the billions. And that will be a federal action that triggers. Of course, we want to be good stewards of the environment, but if you're a community in economic decline, to come up with $1 billion to deal with combined sewer overflow is very difficult, especially when you have things like tax and municipal bonds are on the table for repeal or dramatic change. Dr. Bell?
Well, you did bring up some of the things that I was going to mention, but also just you did ask about the process. In Chesterfield, we use our community planning as a foundation for that process. So we've had special area plans, which goes into the key areas, about 446 square miles. But in 2012, we did a comprehensive redo of the entire comprehensive plan. And in that, and a component of that is the public facilities plan. So we have the long-term comprehensive plan for the community. In that, we had a very, very large cross-sectional group of business and citizens to participate on a steering committee as part of that plan. Many, many, many hours of community engagement sessions, a lot of community feedback sessions, and even when the plan was done, they wanted a redo, so we went back through that again. So with that plan, we have the public facilities plan, which is not necessarily, people think that the public facilities plan, they say I'm funded. No, it's a plan. And so then from there, we go through the five-year CIP planning. But we do have a rudder, if you will, a planning rudder in our comprehensive plan for the community and the associated public facilities plan. Now, as that's for the entire community, but then we're going back in and diving in some of the special area plans, especially for some of our older communities. Community revitalization is one of the key areas. And so then we take a more intensive look for certain sectors or certain parts of the community. Again, a lot of community engagement. Then we get some facilities recommendations from that, and then that feeds into the capital budget. But it's all about affordability. And what our revenues, what our resources look like, and what we can do and stay within our debt capacity.
Well, thank you. We're going to wrap up here, but we wanted to close by thanking our panelists. We also want to thank Congressman Graves of Missouri for helping us with the room today. Just the closing comments are, obviously, state and local perspective, we're looking for predictability from the federal government. We're looking for help, particularly on mega projects that are beyond the revenue generating abilities of state and local government, particularly local government, where we typically have restrictions imposed by the state level on our ability to raise revenue, and we're looking for consistent partnership, so the predictability would also sustain over time. So with that, again, thank you for the opportunity to present on state and local government infrastructure on behalf of all the national sponsors. Thank you again.
Maybe I'll see you around home.
For sure.
Yeah, that's good.
Sorry.